Welcome back to Sky News Sunrise. We're talking about Love Island now. Is it a cultural phenomenon? I can barely say it, but I believe it. Or is it cheap and tacky?
Cheap and tacky.
That is Jonathan's view. Your take on Love Island, please, news at sky.com, at Sky Sarah Jane on Twitter. Honey Lancaster James, a psychologist who has worked on some of these reality TV shows, including some of the early series of Love Island, is here with us now. Honey, good morning to you. Did you watch it? What did you think?
I did watch it. I'm a fan, as well as sort of professionally and personally.
Got back up finally in the studio. He's taken me till 20 past eight.
I think there's no shame in enjoying Love Island. You know, at the end of the day, we are hardwired to be interested in relationships and to be interested in the way people interact with one another. So there's no shame in enjoying a show like that. It's a great way of just switching off and, you know, seeing beautiful people in a beautiful location. I know there's controversy about that. I know people have their opinions about it, but at the end of the day, it makes great TV.
Yeah, it's really divided a nation, or at least divided social media, especially this morning, as soon as we started talking about it. There are those who see it as entertainment, like myself. There are those who think it's utter drivel for various reasons.
Drivel may be too strong, but I loved, when Big Brother started, I thought that was interesting, and I saw it as a sort of an interesting experiment. But I feel with this that they're all so narcissistic, they're so sort of self-serving, they don't really want to fall in love. All they want is £50,000 and loads more followers on Instagram and to become famous. I feel that the calling it Love Island and talking about everyone wanting to fall in love. I mean, the winners last year, they stayed together for a week.
Yes, they're cynical.
Honey, they stayed together for a week.
No, they didn't. They stayed for longer than that.
They fell out of love after a week.
Yeah, OK, they're probably not the best example.
That's my problem with it.
I mean, I think that's a very cynical view. I think, of course, you know, reality TV does attract people who want to boost their media profile or launch a media profile. But I certainly think Love Island is one of those shows that does attract people who are interested in meeting other people. Now, you have to understand, it's a very unique setting to fall in love in. So once you go back to the real world, who knows how those relationships are going to pan out in a very, very different set of circumstances.
Holiday romance, Jonathan. Yeah. I've had a few of those.
I didn't have the cameras filming me, and I wasn't looking for Instagram followers.
It's interesting because it has courted controversy over the contestants they have picked. They are all body beautiful in the Instagram sense of it. There's a lot of talk about diversity as well, but when you looked at that final lineup, there was an ethnic mix. So do you think this controversy is justified?
I think I totally understand why some people are concerned. Certainly, you know, I'm a parent of young adults, and of course we worry that having that kind of exposure to these a number of people who have got the body beautiful, who've got this perfect physique, that the vast majority of us don't live up to. Yes, there's an influence there on making people think, oh, I don't compare, I'm not like that. But you also have to understand that there's a very good reason as well to put a lot of people together of a similar level of attractiveness, because basic social psychology teaches us that you're more likely to be attracted to someone who's of a similar level of attractiveness to yourself. So they can't really put a very diverse mix, because nobody would fall in love if that were the case.
A lot of people have said, what about an older, more real version of Love Island? So people that look like the average person on the street and maybe sort of post 30. Would that work?
Well, I mean, personally, I would probably watch that because I enjoy these kind of shows, and I think that's fascinating as well for a different reason. But you've also got to understand that the generation that this kind of show appeals to have grown up an Instagram generation. They're used to looking at people who are airbrushed or filtered or glossed in some way. So I guess this kind of appeals to them because they are looking for something that's aesthetic.
Isn't that part of the problem, honey? And you talked about, you know, children who are watching it, that these aren't people that really you should aspire to be, these sort of preening wannabes who are out for a celebrity future and a celebrity lifestyle, earning lots of money for the number of followers they have on Instagram. I mean, this isn't a future that we should want our sons and daughters to aspire to, is it?
I'm sure many people would agree with you on that, although I did read a really interesting article yesterday saying that apparently you can make more money out of going on Love Island than you can if you go to Oxford or Cambridge. I'm not sure we want to encourage people down that route. But I also think there's another positive side to it. This season, for example, led to lots of really positive discussions in the media about what are healthy relationship behaviours, what should you put up with and not put up with in a relationship. So whilst there are downsides, I do also think there are potential benefits.
And then showing emotion on the show as well, being just as insecure about relationships and being just as emotional in some cases.
Yeah, more in some cases, I think. We certainly saw that. We saw some softer sides of some of the guys on the show. But I think it's been really helpful for young people to sort of talk to each other about, actually, you know, I wouldn't put up with that. Or that's, oh, look, they're really sweet together. That's the kind of relationship I want for the future.
One of the interesting things I read from a contestant who took part last year was the fact that they didn't have mobile phones with them. You know, you're not allowed a mobile phone, and that encourages them, obviously, to have conversations. And she said that her relationship with her boyfriend changed dramatically when they got phones afterwards.
Yes, yeah, and I think also, of course, when they come out of a show like that, the media frenzy, suddenly a very, very different lifestyle that they're coming back to. But yes, I think you're right. And I do worry, actually, about the impact of mobile phones sort of coming between people. We know that people feel quite rejected if you're having a conversation with someone and they're actually doing this, or they're at the dinner table having on their mobile phones. So yeah.
Okay. Well, Team Janny, who won Jack and Danny, have just posted a picture on social media, a little video, and they're both on their phones. Obviously, she's recording and he's like that texting. So it could be a taste of things to come.
There you go. Nice. We don't know how many weeks it will last then.
Yeah, but good to see a nice guy winning. More Mr. Nice Guy, please, in Jack. Thank you very much for coming to talk to us about Love Island, honey. Keep your thoughts coming in. News at sky.com, at Sky Sarah Jane. Here's Jamie with the sport.